I wanted to pick up back on page 140. They're back at the Weasley's tent, and Arthur Weasley is talking and such, and he says that we found Barty Crouch's elf holding Harry's wand, but we're none the wiser about who actually conjured the mark. Percy, Mr. Crouch's elf, you know. And they explain how Barty Crouch sacked Winky. Percy, well, Mr. Crouch is quite right to get rid of an elf like that. Running away when he expressly told her not to. Embarrassing him in front of, notice, embarrassing him in front of the whole ministry. Really? The whole ministry? How many people were there?
15.
Yeah, but were they all ministry wizards? I believe we were told Arthur Weasley was there and Amos Diggory, who has a minor position in the ministry. Okay. They keep talking, and then, you know, Hermione mentions the dark mark. And on page 142, Mr. Weasley, when Ron says, I mean, I don't get it. I don't, what's the big deal about the image in the sky? Ron, you know who and his followers sent the dark mark into the air whenever they killed. So seeing the dark mark was a warning sign, even though the kids didn't realize it. The terror it inspired, you have no idea. You're too young. Now, we're going to hear that two or three times in the novel before finally, you know, Ron says to Sirius, you know, I'm tired of people saying that. Try us, why don't you? Okay? Just picture coming home, finding the dark mark hovering over your house, knowing what you're about to find inside. Everyone's worst fear, the very worst. Okay? Jump to book five. After the party they have, you know, to celebrate Harry's getting off from the charges by the ministry. And what does Mrs. Weasley see upstairs? There's a boggart in the desk in the drawing room. And she sees, you know, Flash, Ginny dead, Ron dead, Percy dead, Bill and Charlie dead, Arthur dead, Harry dead, Hermione dead, you know. There's no dark mark. But what that's showing us is that's her worst fear. Okay? Silence for a moment. Bill, well, it didn't help us tonight, whoever conjured it. Scared the Death Eaters away the moment they saw it. They all disapparated before we got near enough to unmask any of them. Okay? Harry, Death Eaters? What are Death Eaters? It's what You-Know-Who supporters called themselves. Okay? Do they know what it means? Death Eaters? Eating death? Taking death inside yourself? Overcoming death? Okay? Ron talks about meeting Draco in the wood. Harry, but Harry's still trying to figure out, but what were Voldemort's supporters, what were they doing? Why were they levitating those people? What's this question by Harry tell us about Harry? He's so good. He doesn't have a sick bone inside him. In other words, Mr. Weasley, the point? Harry, that's their idea of fun. Half the muggle killings back when You-Know-Who was in power were done for fun. Notice that. Half the muggle killings were done for fun. No purpose. That is, they weren't extracting information. It wasn't torture for information. It was sheer pleasure. He says, I suppose I had a few drinks tonight, couldn't resist. Ron, but if they were Death Eaters, why'd they disapparate when the dark mark? Bill, come on, Harry. Come on, Ron. You think they really want it all to happen again? He says, if they really were Death Eaters, they worked very hard to keep out of Azkaban when You-Know-Who lost power. And so if they really did see the dark mark, then You-Know-Who's back, they would be a little bit afraid of what that means for them. I don't reckon he'd be overpleased. Do you? Hermione, so whoever conjured the dark mark Were they showing support for the Death Eaters or to scare them away? Leave it to Hermione to get to the important question. All right? Mr. Weasley, don't really know, Hermione. That's a good question. Okay? So we get the chapter, Mayhem at the Ministry, and what do we find out? Mr. Weasley's in deep trouble because he said some things he maybe should not have said. Percy sides with Rita Skeeter, really, in the ministry and against his father. And Mrs. Weasley doesn't really appreciate that all that much. Okay, so we're going to skip a bunch. Turn to page 151. I really hope none of you get whatever it is I have, because it just doesn't let go. And the reason I wanted you to turn to 151 was to look at the clock that Molly Weasley has. Mrs. Weasley glanced at the grandfather clock in the corner. Harry liked this clock. Completely useless if you wanted to know the time, but otherwise very informative. 9 golden hands, each of them engraved with one of the Weasley family's names. No numerals around the face, but descriptions of where each family member might be. Home, school, work, traveling, lost, hospital, prison, mortal peril. Would you really want this clock in your home? Would you really ever want to see one of the family members' names at mortal peril? I mean, it's as scary as all get-out clock, all right? 8 of the hands pointing to home, Mr. Weasley's pointing to work. And Molly Weasley says, top of the next page, your father hasn't had to go into the office on weekends since the days of you-know-who. What's Rowling telling us? Those days are back. What did Bane tell Hagrid when they went off into the Forbidden Forest in book 1? Mars is bright tonight. Okay. Mars is bright tonight. And that's when Percy says, you know, well, Father's got to make up for the mistake he made. And Mrs. Weasley tells him to shut it, essentially. Skip a bunch again and go to page 165. Harry overhears Harry, Ron, and Hermione over here Draco talking to I don't think it's Crabbe and Goyle. I think it's Pansy Parkinson. I don't see her name anywhere on here. But they're eavesdropping, and they hear Draco say, Father actually considered sending me to Durmstrang rather than Hogwarts. You know, he knows the headmaster. You know his opinion of Dumbledore. The man's such a mudblood lover. Durmstrang doesn't admit that sort of riffraff. Father says Durmstrang takes a far more sensible line than Hogwarts about the dark arts. Durmstrang students actually learn them, not just the defense rubbish. Durmstrang comes from a German phrase, Sturm und Drang, which means storm and stress. It was a 19th century kind of thematic movement in literature, where you put people kind of in a crucible. You put them in a very stressful environment and then see how they react and such. Okay, you do actually even have it, you see it in some English novels of the 19th century. Oh, I knew that was going to happen. And there's one very famous one, Heathcliff and Wuthering Heights, okay, by Jane Austen. Largely does this, where you have, you know, all kinds of atmospheric effects, you know, storms and such, but then you also have emotional storm and stress going on. Okay, so Harry learns, comes to realize, oh, there's more than one wizarding school, and Hermione's like, hello, Harry, there's lots of wizarding schools. Haven't you, you know. So notice what Draco has said there, however. Why is he at Hogwarts? It's too far away from his mommy. Okay? He's a mama's boy. Father wants to send him off there to really, you know, become a man, as it were, to learn the real dark arts, but mummy doesn't want him to. Go on to the next chapter, the Triwizard Tournament. They go off to school, they get to school, and we see our second song by the Sorting Hat. Notice how different this is than the first song. This is on pages 176 and 77. A thousand years or more ago, when I was newly sown, there lived four wizards of renown whose names are still well known. Bold Gryffindor from Wild Moor, fair Ravenclaw from Glen, sweet Hufflepuff, from Valley Broad, shrewd Slytherin from Finn. What's a Finn? Swamp. Okay. Everybody else has a nice place to live, and the Slytherins come from the swamps. They shared a wish, a hope, a dream. They hatched a daring plan to educate young sorcerers. Thus Hogwarts School began, we're told. Now each of these four founders formed their own house. For each did value different virtues and the ones they had to teach. Now notice this. You have four houses, okay, and the founders each specify or want to mentor certain virtues. So the four houses are founded on the basis of particular virtues, okay? So what are these virtues? By Gryffindor, the bravest were prized far beyond the best. The rest. So Gryffindor prizes bravery above everything else. For Ravenclaw, the cleverest, brains, would always be the best. For Hufflepuff, hard work, okay, were most worthy of admission. And power-hungry Slytherin loved those of great ambition. Now think about these each for a minute. Is there any difference between one of these and the others? That is one of them different in some way than the other three? What?
Well, Slytherin ambition isn't always a good thing.
Okay.
And it's often sought by people who don't deserve it.
Okay. It's true.
I think Hufflepuff maybe because the other three are kind of things that you just have in you, and hard work is something you have to apply yourself to.
Exactly. Exactly. This is actual doing. Okay? You can be born, however, with courage. Yeah, it does need to be demonstrated in order to really have it. Okay? But you can be brave, kind of intellectually or in your soul, as it were. Hard work doesn't exist necessarily inside. It must be shown. Okay? Ambition, it's all internal. Brains, it's all internal. You either have it or you don't. Okay? This is, you know, high IQ, as it were. Okay? So, while still alive, they did divide their favorites from the throng. Now notice this. The throng. Think of the throng as like this. And so they divide their favorites. Okay? How to pick the worthy ones when they were dead and gone? 'Twas Gryffindor who found the way. He whipped me off his head. So who does the sorting hat belong to? Gryffindor. It's going to be something that will come up in book 7 in terms of when they're looking for Horcruxes. And we're told, well, there's really only one relic left of Godfrey Gryffindor. Not true. There are two, at least. Okay? 'Twas Gryffindor who found the way. He whipped me off his head. The founders put some brains in me so I could choose instead. Now slip me snug about your ears. I've never yet been wrong. I'll have a look inside your mind and tell where you belong. And the hat stops. Okay? So what are they going to do? They're going to take the throng, the whole group of students, first years, and what do? They divide them. Gryffindor, Ravenclaw, Hufflepuff, Slytherin. Okay? You take the whole and you divide it. So what happens when you divide it? Do this. What is now left here? Separation. Gaps. It's no longer a whole, in other words. It's fragmented. Okay? This notion, Rowling is going to play up beginning in book 5. And we'll play it up even more and more as they go along. Okay? We're going to hear the Sorting Hat sing one more song, if I remember correctly. Yeah, in fact, in book 5. That is going to emphasize the effect of this quartering. Okay? So, we see people sorted off into the various houses. And then Dumbledore has some words. Hermione learns that there are house elves at Hogwarts and starts to go all crazy. And then Dumbledore explains how there will not be, before he does that, Mad-Eye Moody comes in, new defense against the dark arts teacher, okay, which, you know, nose is half missing and scars all over his face and all this kind of stuff. And then Dumbledore explains that there will be no Quidditch this year. And he says at the bottom of 186 and on 187, it's because of the Triwizard Tournament. And he talks about a little bit the Triwizard Tournament, established some 700 years ago, friendly competition between the European schools, okay, the largest European schools. And said, you know, that in the past, however, you know, too many witches or wizards would die, so, you know, they had to stop it. But now he says, you know, we're starting it again and we've got safety mechanisms in place to make sure nobody dies. But he says at the end of October, the heads of Durmstrang and Beauxbatons will come with their charges. That is, with the students that will vie for an opportunity to participate in the Triwizard Tournament. And he says, in order to make sure everybody is safe, what's going to be the cutoff point? You have to be 17. How old are Fred and George at this point?
16.
They won't turn 17 until the following April, I believe it is. Okay? So, we have to wait a while for the Triwizard Tournament to begin. And we get the next chapter, Mad-Eye Moody. I'm going to skip a bunch. We see the Daily Prophet article about mistakes at the ministry where Arthur Weasley is mentioned as Arnold Weasley, which Malfoy thinks is quite funny because his father apparently is so insignificant they can't even get his name right. And then Harry says, page 204, to Malfoy, you know your mother, Malfoy? That expression she's got, like she's got dung under her nose? Has she always looked like that, or was it just because you were with her? Notice Malfoy's face goes pink. Don't you dare insult my father. Then keep your fat mouth shut then. What's Harry showing here? Why does he do this? He's standing up for Molly Weasley, who is almost like a surrogate mother to Harry. I mean, when Ron, Fred, and George bring Harry to the Burrow in book two, does Harry get in trouble? No. Do Ron, Fred, and George? They get an earful. It's, oh, Harry dear, you know, let me fatten you up. It's not your fault you flew in a flying car, you know, kind of a thing. So Malfoy tries to curse Harry, and we hear, oh, no, you don't, laddie. Did he get you? Moody asked Harry. No, missed. Leave it. Harry, what? Not you, him, he says to Crab, who's about to pick up the white ferret that's on the ground kind of shaking. I don't think so, as the ferret tries to scurry off, and it jumps up into the air 10 feet. 10 feet's the height of the ceiling. Okay? So it goes up to the ceiling, and then wham! Bounces off the ground, and then goes up 10 feet again. Wham! My son's got two ferrets, you know. You do this to one ferret, it's dead. I don't think so. I don't like people to attack when their opponent's back's turned. Stinking, a cowardly, scummy thing to do. Never do that again. Wham, 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 on each syllable, that's a word. Professor Moody! Yeah. McGonagall comes in. Hello, Professor McGonagall. What are you doing? They're both Scots, you know. Teaching. Moody, is that a student? Yep. No! You know. McGonagall, by the rules. You know. Notice, we never use transfiguration as a punishment. Transfiguration ought to be something students want to experience, as it were. He goes, and she says, surely Professor Dumbledore mentioned that. He might have mentioned it, yeah, but I thought a good sharp shock, you know, beat some sense into the boy. We give detentions, Moody. I'm a father. I spank my kids. I think Moody's approach is a lot more effective than is detentions, okay? He says, okay, then I'll speak to his head of house. What does he say? Oops, wrong page. Hold on a second. That'll be Snape then. Another old friend. Been looking forward to a chat with old Snape. Come on, you. And Ron's like, shh. I want to hold that memory in my mind for a minute. Okay. So they go off in the next chapter to Moody's class. Now think about the defense against the dark arts teachers they've had thus far. Book one, Quirrell. Right-hand man, so to speak, of Voldemort. Book two, Mr. In Love with Himself, Gilderoy Lockhart. Book three, Remus John Lupin, a good defense against the dark arts teacher. Okay, if he'd been allowed to, you can only imagine what he would have done with other students. I mean, he taught Harry the Patronus Charm. And now we get Moody. And how does Moody start off class? The unforgivable curses. This is like, you know, we're going from A to Z. We're going to some of the most difficult kind of stuff to learn. And Ron, you know, asks if he's not staying. He says, no, I've given Dumbledore 1 year. And he says, you're Arthur Weasley's son, right? He goes, yeah, yeah, yeah. So he says, okay, so straight into it. Curses, page 211. Now, according to the Ministry of Magic, I'm supposed to teach you counter curses and leave it at that. I'm not supposed to show you what illegal dark curses look like until you're in the sixth year. You're not supposed to be old enough to deal with it till then. Notice that? You're not supposed to be old enough. Okay? But Professor Dumbledore's got a higher opinion of your nerves. He reckons you can cope. And I say the sooner you know what you're up against, the better. Dumbledore thinks you're ready for this. The ministry doesn't. What do we see right there? Dumbledore and the ministry are at odds. Okay? How are you supposed to defend yourself against something you've never seen? Pretty good question. So, he asks, what are the most heavily punishable curses? Ron, Imperius curse? Your father would know that one. Gave the ministry a lot of trouble at one time, the Imperius curse. So he takes out three spiders, or takes out a spider. Okay? Ron kind of, you know, juts back. Points his wand, Imperio. And the spider starts to do backflips and tap dances, you know, all this kind of stuff. And everybody's laughing. Think it's funny, do you? You'd like it, would you, if I did it to you? Obviously not. Nobody wants to be made a fool of. Total control. I can make it jump out of the window, drown yourself, throw itself down one of your throats. And Ron kind of, you know, backs up even more. So he says, years back, a lot of witches and wizards were under the Imperius curse. You can't tell who is and who isn't. But it can be fought, notice. And I'll be teaching you how, but it takes real strength of character. So it takes character to fight off an Imperius curse. Better avoid being hit with it. How do you avoid being hit with it? Constant vigilance. That's how. Constant vigilance. When I taught my first Harry Potter course in London, summer of 2003, you know, which was just a couple of years after this book came out, and it's the year book 5 came out that summer, you would literally see on the walls and tube stations or on the inside of buses, signs with two words, constant vigilance, because of 9/11 having happened. Okay, it was, you know, if you see a strange object, report it, be on the lookout, be aware. It was like walking into the Harry Potter world because of how aware everybody was of problems. Okay. Now, what did he say it took to repel or to fight off the Imperius curse? Strength of character. In the next lesson, who fights off the Imperius curse? Harry. So Harry has strength of character. Why? Or you could just say, Harry has character. How do you get character?
You don't.
It's built through hard lessons.
It's built through hard lessons. What kind of hard lessons? How much is life? It's built through suffering. Built through enduring. St. Paul says somewhere, you know, so-and-so builds endurance, endurance builds, and this builds character. Adversity builds character. Okay? Harry repels it. Well, what kind of adversity has Harry had?
Books 1, 2, 3.
He's lived with the Dursleys. He's been Dudley's punching bag. He's had to learn how to get away from Dudley. He's had to learn how to deal with suffering. He's had a lot of suffering in his life, right? He thought his parents died in an automobile crash. And then he comes to learn, no, they were ours because somebody attempted to murder him. That's a pretty big deal of suffering that he had to deal with quickly. He didn't have 11 years to deal with that. He had like a month. At most, okay? And in book 2, he endures more suffering. He has to repel Voldemort, the young Voldemort, the capable Voldemort. What had Voldemort already done? The 16-year-old Voldemort. By the time that memory or that image of Voldemort meets Harry in the Chamber of Secrets.
He opened the chamber.
Okay. He'd opened the chamber, killed his parents already, or his father and grandparents. He'd already committed, by that time, 3 murders. At least. That's, okay. Book 3. Harry has to relive his parents' deaths. He hears his mother's cries for mercy. Not Harry. No, please, not Harry. Mercy. Okay? So now when he goes home and dreams, he probably still hears his mother's voice sometimes and his father's voice. He has suffered a lot. Has Ron suffered? He suffered poverty. Not the same. Who definitely would not be able to put off the Imperius curse? Hermione. Why? Character isn't something you read in a book. She's got an easy life. Her parents are dentists. They rake in the bucks. Okay? Dudley would not be able to, even if Dudley were a wizard. Dudley's had an easy life. He's never gone without. Might be able to. Neville. Neville's had a hard life. After all, he lives with his grandmother. And look at the depiction we get of her. And then what do we see? What do we learn in book 5 about Neville?
His parents
are at St. Mungo's. They're not dead. He's lived with his grandmother all these years, but his parents aren't dead. And he visits them. And what happens? His mother seemingly, every time he visits him, brings him a gum wrapper and gives it to him. Or at least at Christmas. If we could take the example that we get in book 5 as being what happens every Christmas, because what does Neville's grandmother tell him? Throw it away, dear. You must have enough of those already to paper your wall. That shows us how often Neville visits. He doesn't only visit once a year. He visits when he's home at Christmas. He visits if he's home probably in the Easter holidays. Okay. And he's gotten a number of these things. So, go on to the next curse. Anybody know another one? Neville raises hand and they're like, Neville? Cruciatus? Needs to be a bit bigger for you to get the idea. Ingorgio, and makes the spider get large. Crucio, and the spider falls on its back and its legs just curl in and quiver. And what does Neville do? He holds the chair in front of him and his knuckles get white because he's gripping it so hardly until Hermione tells Moody to stop. Hermione doesn't know why Neville does that. We don't learn until the end of this book. Well, not quite the end, but. Okay? Pain. You don't need thumb screws or knives to torture someone if you could perform the Cruciatus curse. Cruciatus comes from crucio. What's it mean? Cross. It's like a crucifixion curse. Okay? He goes, all right. Any others? Hermione. Avada Kedavra. The last and worst. He puts his hand in the glass jar, and that poor little spider's like, no, 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 not me, not me. You know. Puts it on the table, Avada Kedavra. There's a flash of blinding green light, a rushing sound, as though a vast, invisible something was soaring through the air. Instantaneously, the spire rolled over onto its back, unmarked but unmistakably dead. And several of the children stifle cries. What is the vast, invisible something soaring through the air? Is it death coming to take the spider, or is it life leaving? It's probably yes. And Harry thinks, so that's how my parents died. A green flash, and that was it. Harry had been picturing his parents' death over and over and over for 3 years now, ever since he'd find out they'd been murdered. Wormtail had betrayed his parents' whereabouts to Voldemort, how Voldemort had killed Harry's father first, how James Potter tried to hold him off. Voldemort advanced on Lily, told her to move aside. She begged him to kill her instead. Voldemort murdered her too. He knew these details. And he's just reliving all this. Meanwhile, Moody's talking. Avada Kedavra is a curse that needs a powerful bit of magic behind it. You could all get your wands out now, point them at me, and say the words, I doubt I get so much as a nosebleed. Why? Okay. What does Harry learn in book 5? From Bellatrix Lestrange. You have to mean it. If you're going to do the Crucio curse, you must want to inflict pain. In fact, it's more than just wanting to inflict pain. You must enjoy the afflicting of pain. You, in other words, have got to get your jollies by seeing somebody else writhing in pain. Which means you got to be kind of sick. Which, keep in mind, Harry does it in book 7. When he uses it on one of the Caro twins. And he's like, Bellatrix was right. You have to enjoy it. Okay? McGonagall's like, Paul, you should have done that, you know. So, what does he say? Now, if there's no counter curse, page 217, why am I showing you? Because you've got to know. You've got to appreciate what the worst is. You don't want to find yourself in a situation where you're facing it. Constant vigilance. Now, those three curses, Avada Kedavra, Imperius, and Cruciatus, are known as the unforgivable curses. The use of any one of them on a fellow human being is enough to earn a life sentence in Azkaban. That's what you're up against. Well, that's what I've got to teach you to fight. You need preparing. You need arming. But most of all, you need to practice constant, never-ceasing vigilance. So, you use one of those, life sentence in Azkaban. Harry uses one in book 7. He doesn't get a life sentence in Azkaban. Okay? Why? I don't think that's necessarily an example of bad writing. I think that's an example of, there's exceptions. The law can be bent at certain points.
Such as for teaching methods.
Yeah. So, they leave, and Moody takes Neville up to his office, says, I hear you're good at herbology. I've got a book, you know, you might be interested in. And Neville shows them the book, Water Plants of the Mediterranean, Magical Water Plants of the Mediterranean. Okay? And they go off, excuse me, to the Gryffindor Common Room, and page 226, Hermione comes in, has come in. She has her little, like, cigar box of badges and stuff, and she has started SPEW. Okay? Society for the Protection or Preservation or Promotion, I can't remember what it is. Society for the Promotion of Elfish Welfare. Okay? Because Ron hears SPEW, which means, like, vomit. Okay. And she's going, no, not SPEW, S-P-E-W. She hasn't come up with a very good acronym. But anyways, they're sitting there, and Hedwig shows up with a note from Sirius. Page 226, I'm flying north immediately. This news about your scar is the latest in a series of strange rumors that have reached me here. If it hurts again, go straight to Dumbledore. They're saying he's got Mad-Eye out of retirement, which means he's reading the signs. Notice Sirius doesn't say what the signs are. He just says, there are strange rumors. I'm coming. Keep your eyes open. Okay? And Harry starts to think. He's lying in his bed at night, page 227. He's thinking, if Sirius comes up here and Sirius gets caught, and Sirius has to go back to Azkaban or get the Dementor's kiss, it'll be my fault. Showing he hasn't learned what? Yeah. That Sirius has free choice too. Showing that he hasn't learned the lesson that Dumbledore attempted to teach him at the end of the previous year. Okay? So, beginning of the next chapter, Harry sends a message back to Sirius. Nah, don't worry about it. Don't come up north. Okay? So we get Bobatol and Durmstrang. And it's their next defense against the dark arts. And Moody says, I'm going to be putting you under the Imperius curse. And Hermione's like, but you said anybody who puts another fellow human being under one of these curses immediately earns a life sentence to Azkaban. And he says, Dumbledore wants you taught what it feels like. If you'd rather learn the hard way, when someone's putting it on you so they can control you completely, fine by me, your excuse, off you go. And Hermione's like, I don't want to go. I want to see it. I don't want it happening to me. And then he puts Harry under it. It was the most wonderful feeling. Harry felt a floating sensation as every thought and worry in his head was wiped gently away, leaving nothing but a vague, untraceable happiness. He stood there feeling immensely relaxed. Okay? Only dimly aware of everyone watching him. Why? Why does he feel so wonderful?
Because he doesn't have to think for himself.
He doesn't have to think for himself. What else? You're most of the way there. What's happened to his self? It's gone. Okay. When you're put under an imperious curse, the other person's will takes control. The other person's self takes control. It's like you are gone. So you no longer have any wants, any desires, any needs. If you no longer have any wants, desires, and needs, if you were to look into the mirror of Erised, what would you see? Okay, assuming you're not under an Imperius curse. If you don't have any wants, desires, and needs, what do you see? Yourself. Yourself. Okay? Perfectly at peace. The only difference is that here you are under someone else's. And so he hears Mad-Eye's voice telling him, jump onto the desk, jump onto the desk. And Harry bends his knees. But then another voice says, why? A little voice in the back of his brain, why? Why jump onto the desk? Stupid thing to do, really. No, I don't think I will, thanks. And so what happens? Part of him tries to obey, and part of him tries not to obey. So he bangs his knees on the desk. Now that's more like it. Look at that, you lot. Potter fought it. Fought it, and he damn near beat it. First time you hear a teacher swear in the story. We'll try that again, Potter. The rest of you, pay attention. Watch his eyes. That's where you see it. Very good, very good indeed. Okay. Harry hobbles out of the defense against the dark arts because his knees are sore. He's been put under the Imperius curse 4 times in a row. And by that time, he could throw it off entirely. Okay. He's a fourth year student. And at this point in his fourth year, the beginning of his fourth year, he can now completely repel an Imperius curse. What's this tell us about Harry? Don't mess with him. Talent? Oh my yes. The Sorting Hat says. Okay. Ron talks about Moody as being paranoid. Okay. They're talking about their owls and such. They see the sign about the Triwizard Tournament, about when the delegations will arrive. Okay. Pages 238-39, they're talking about the house elves. And Fred and George tell Hermione how happy the house elves are. They love nothing more than serving witches and wizards. You know, Fred and George go down to the kitchens and they come back up with their arms stuffed full of eclairs and all kinds of food. 240, Harry gets a letter back from Sirius. Nice try. I'm back in the country. Well hidden, okay. Don't worry about me, in other words. So, they go off to welcome the Beauxbatons and Durmstrang. And what do we see? The Beauxbatons come in on a magical carriage drawn by giant horses. Kind of like what? Does it remind you of any Disney thing? Cinderella. It's what it is. It's an enchanted carriage drawn by giant horses. Giant horses who happen to love single malt Scotch whiskey. Okay, horses after my own heart, as it were. How does Durmstrang arrive? A boat in the lake, you know, comes up from underneath like, you know, Pirates of the Caribbean almost. Okay. And what do we see? We see Madame Maxime come in and she greets Dumbledore and Hagrid and such. And she's tall. Dumbledore's head comes up to her chest. Okay. And then we see Karkaroff and his charges come up. And we see Victor Crumb is among them. Dumbledore says the tournament will begin at the end of the feast, blah, 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 blah. Triwizard Tournament's about to start. Bagman and Crouch are there. Page 256. Dumbledore tells all the students, to ensure that no underage student yields to temptation, I'll be drawing an age line around the Goblet of Fire once it has been placed in the entrance hall. Nobody under the age of 17 will be able to cross this line. Notice, he's not actually stopping them from yielding to temptation. They're still tempted. And they do still give in. He's not allowing them to fulfill their temptations, however. Okay? And what does he tell them? If your name is put in the Goblet of Fire and your name is chosen, it constitutes a binding magical contract. In other words, you can't get out of it. You can't say, oh, I decide not to. We're not told what will happen if you try to get out of the contract. We're not told that, for example, in book 6, okay, with the contract that Snape does with Narcissa, that if you try to break that one, you know, you die. We're not told that that's going to happen here, but it's implied something horrible will happen. Okay? So, skip a bunch. Fred and George try and get across, and they get repelled, though they do end up with nice beards. Page 265. They're talking with Hagrid about the house elves, and Hagrid tells Hermione, freeing the house elves, doing what Hermione wants to do. It'd be doing them an unkindness, Hermione. It's in their nature to look after humans. That's what they like, see? You'd be making them unhappy to take away their work and insulting them if you tried to pay them. Now, notice what Hagrid has said. If Hermione does what she wants to do, what must she do to the house elves? Make them unemployed. Okay, what else? She has to ruin their lives. That is, to make them aware that they are in slavery. To make them aware that they are in servitude. She has to make them miserable so that she can then free them. But will they be less miserable once they are aware that they are miserable? No. I could be completely wrong here. I think this is Rowling trying to tell readers something about the law of unintended consequences. And especially trying to tell maybe readers more on her side of the political spectrum, okay, which is the leftist side, the liberal side, that, you know, sometimes we should leave well enough alone. That sometimes we think we've got all the answers and we try to make people better, but what do? Instead, we only make them worse off. Okay? It's like that line that Aragorn says in Lord of the Rings, where he says, you know, the Rangers, the Dunedain of the North, it's our job to keep people simple and happy. If they don't know anything about the larger world, if they don't know anything about the dangers that lurk outside, so be it. It's better for them to remain unknowing and happy than for them to what? Know and be fearful. Okay? I could be wrong there, but I think that's partially what Rowling is saying. So, we get to the actual time where the chamber or the casket will spit out the names. The first name flies out. It's Victor Crumb. Like there's ever going to be any doubt. Okay? And then the champion for Beauxbatons. Anybody know what Beauxbatons means? B-E-A-U-X means beautiful. Baton? Wands. Beautiful wands. Well, look at the description of the Beauxbatons students. They're all gorgeous. Okay? Just so happens to be that Fleur has, you know, is part Vila. So, Fleur Delacour. Look, I mean, just her name. Fleur. Flower. Delacour. Of the heart. Flower of the heart. Okay? And you know, and Ron's sitting there drooling all over her. Hogwarts champion, Cedric Diggory, Mr. Pretty Boy himself. Hufflepuff champion. Okay. But he's also described as what? Throughout the, you know, where it's described in this book and in book two. He's gorgeous. I mean, he's hunk. Ron, no! You know, anybody but him. You know, somebody slightly deformed, misshapen would be better with Ron. And then Harry's name comes out. Harry, come on. You know, Harry's like, what? Everybody's quiet. Ron looks at him. Harry goes back. They have the little conference behind in the one room. Madame Maxime and Igor Karkaroff are very upset. After all, their houses don't have two champions. Bagman says, you know, page 277, we got to follow the rules. The rules say if your name comes out, you got to participate. Okay? And Karkaroff and Maxime say there's something funny going on here. And Moody finally says, you're right, there is something funny. Maybe someone, page 279 at the top, maybe someone's hoping Potter is going to die for it. And they're like, oh, great, here's, you know, paranoid Moody again. Madame Maxime, what evidence is there that somebody wants Harry dead? Because they hoodwinked a very powerful magical object. It would have needed an exceptionally strong Confundus charm to bamboozle that goblet. And forgetting that only three schools compete in the tournament. After all, what's the tournament called? Tri-Wizard. It's not the Quad-Wizard. Okay, Quad-Wizard.
Is Moody bragging here
Yeah, I think so. I'm guessing they submitted Potter's name under a fourth school to make sure he was the only one in his category. You seem to have given a great deal of thought to this, Moody. And Moody says, it's my job to think the way dark wizards do, Karkaroff, as you ought to remember. Dumbledore's like, Moody, chill, man. Because what's he about to do? He's about to spill the beans about Karkaroff. That Karkaroff was brought before the Weisengamot for being a dark wizard and such. So, everybody agrees. They've got to do it. Cedric and Harry, page 282. Cedric, so we're playing against each other again. They had the Quidditch match back in book two. Harry's, you know, poor broom. Was it book two or book three? Book three. Two, three, three. Yeah, three, when the Whomping Willow destroyed his broom and then Siri sent the new one. Harry, Cedric says, so, how did you get in? Harry, I didn't. I was telling the truth. Well, okay. See ya. What does that tell us about Cedric? Is he? Does he believe Harry?
I wouldn't say that. He's just kind of like, he takes it as competition. It's not.
Okay.
He's still focused on us.
Yeah, but he says, I mean, after Harry says, I was telling the truth. Ah, okay. See you then. Do you take that passage as Cedric saying, right, I believe you, Harry? I don't. I think he's saying, okay, fine, keep it to yourself. You don't need to tell me. The reason it's important is because what happens when Harry goes up to the Gryffindor Common Room? Everybody's cheering him on except, well, you know, you said you would sneak down by yourself and, you know, I thought you would have at least would have told me. Harry, I told you I didn't do it. Well, yeah, sure. Ron's final response is almost identical to Cedric's. Ron doesn't believe Harry. It's very clear. Okay. Page 286. Ron says, congratulations. Harry, what do you mean? Well, no one else got across the edge line. Harry says, the invisibility cloak wouldn't have got me. Well, okay, I thought you might have told me. But you found another way. Harry, I didn't put my name in the goblet. Someone else did. Well, why would they do that? I don't know. Notice he doesn't say, because Moody thinks they're trying to kill me. It's okay, you could tell me the truth. If you don't want anyone else to know, fine. But I don't know why you're bothering to lie. You didn't get into trouble for it. I mean, 1,000 galleons if you win? I didn't put my name in the goblet. Okay. Yeah, okay. Go back to. Ah, okay. Is what Cedric says. I'm not stupid, you know, Ron says. You're doing a really good impression of it. Not very good for the old friendship at that point. Okay. So we have the Weighing of the Wands. Harry sends a message off to Sirius. I'm in the Triwizard Tournament. Somebody put my name in. It wasn't me. Thought you should know. Okay. And they go off to class for Hagrid. Hagrid has blast-ended Scroots. Malfoy's made the signs that say, support the real Hogwarts champion, Cedric Diggory, and Potter Stinks, etc. And what happens just outside Snape's classroom? Harry, Malfoy get in a fight. Malfoy tries to zap Harry with the spell. Harry tries to zap Malfoy. Malfoy misses Harry, hits Hermione, and what's the spell? Dentist, teeth, algio, which means grow or increase. Now, Hermione already has large front teeth. How large do her front teeth now grow? Down past her bottom lip. She runs upstairs because Snape says, I don't notice any difference. Which really shows you what about Snape. He's not nice. He is really mean. Okay? It's not evil. Doesn't make him evil. Just makes him really cruel. So Harry gets points taken away. Hermione runs up to the hospital wing and such. And they're getting ready for the weighing of the wands. And Rita Skeeter takes Harry into her broom closet and her quill just starts to write on its own. And Harry's like, well, I'm not crying. What are you know? Until he gets rescued by Dumbledore. Okay. And so we see Ollivander do the weighing of the wands and all that kind of stuff. And then he comes to Harry. And he says, page 310. Ah, how well I remember. Okay. Curious, curious. So they do the photos and such. And Harry gets another letter from Sirius, bottom of 312. Okay, so he tells Harry, be at the fireplace in the Gryffindor common room on the morning of November 22nd. That is, be there at 1 o'clock in the morning. He says, I know you can look after yourself. While you're around Dumbledore and Moody, I think you're safe. Okay, but somebody entered you in that tournament. Somebody's out to get you. We get chapter 19, the Hungarian Horntail. And what happens? The Daily Prophet comes out. And we read the article about Harry. Crying himself to sleep at night. Finding love at Hogwarts with Hermione Granger. It's like, what? Okay. And he sees Cho. It's really the first time Cho's brought in, okay, and I'm going to skip a bunch. Page 322, Moody tells Harry his eye can see through invisibility cloaks. It's useful at times. So what does that tell Harry? Don't try and sneak past Moody with your invisibility cloak, because he can see you, okay? So Harry goes off with Hagrid on the night of November 22nd, because Hagrid wants to show him something, and Hagrid's all dressed up, and he doesn't really understand what's going on. Harry doesn't. And Hagrid goes off, kind of meets Madame Maxime. And then Hagrid takes Harry and shows him dragons. Well, what do we know about Hagrid and dragons? He loves them. He's always wanted one, etc. And Harry now realizes he's got to get past the dragons and get to the egg. Okay? Harry sees Madame Maxime's been there, so Fleur definitely knows. And Karkaroff knows, so Krum knows. So Harry, Fleur, and Victor Krum all know. Who doesn't?
Cedric.
Cedric. Okay. So Harry gets back to the Gryffindor common room. He runs in. He sees Sirius. Sirius tells him about the things he's been hearing. Death Eaters being more active, page 333. Bertha Jorkins missing, okay? She was a ministry witch, he says. She would have known about the Triwizard Tournament, okay? The dragons, they start to talk about, and Sirius has to leave, okay? So we get the first task. The next morning, Harry sees Cedric. And page 340. He hits Cedric with a spell from behind, makes his bag rip open so he can run up to him and help him with everybody else not paying any attention. And he tells Cedric, dragons. The first task is dragons. Cedric, what? Dragons. They've got four, one for each of us. We've got to get past them. Cedric, how do you know? I know. I've seen them. Harry doesn't want to tell him how he knows because he doesn't want to get Hagrid in trouble. He just says, we're not supposed to know. Harry says, just try again. Okay? And then Moody catches him. But Cedric, before Moody catches him, Cedric asks, why are you telling me this? Harry, it's fair. Now we're all on even playing ground, as it were. Okay? We're on an even footing. So Moody says, come with me, Potter. That was a very decent thing you just did. Middle of 342. And he goes on to explain cheating is entirely, you know, part of the rules, as it were. So he tells Harry, you know about the dragons. You know what you have to do, don't you? Harry's like, no. Come on. Play to your strengths. Well, what are Harry's strengths? He's not the smartest student in school. What's he good at? Flying. Harry's like, flying. I'm good at flying. Got to get past the dragons. I haven't got any strengths at it. What are you best at? Well, Quidditch, fat lot of help. That's right. You're a damn good flyer from what I've heard. Yeah, but I'm not allowed a broom. I've only got my wand. Second piece of advice, get what you need. Harry looks at him blankly. Come on, boy! In other words, damn, you stupid, aren't you? Okay? And it clicks. Oh, I gotta get my broom. Well, golly gee, what have they been practicing in Flitwick's charms class? Oxio. Only Harry's no good at it, so Hermione has to help him. Okay? And they find out when they go down for their actual first test, they have to collect the golden egg. Okay? And I'm going to skip over the actual getting of the egg and all that kind of stuff. We see the others, and then we see Harry. Notice how many pages in the book is Harry's getting around the dragon? It's like maybe three. How long is it in the film? It's like 20 or 30 minutes. It's really long, okay?
They changed it too.
Well, yeah, I mean, the dragon's flying all over Hogwarts and Harry's not in the pen and all that kind of stuff, okay? Something I discovered in 2009, in London, I visited the cabinet war rooms of Winston Churchill. I've been there in 95, but they changed them from 95. That is, they opened up more of the underground space and they brought out more material. Okay, and it turns out that during the Second World War, as the Brits or the Allies would decipher German secret code, they had a machine called the Enigma machine that was used to decipher German code. As they would do that, and they would get code cracked, they would put the cracked code in something to be delivered to Churchill. The thing they put the code in were these golden eggs that had hinges on them. Churchill was the only one who would see them. That is, from the time the code was cracked, the code, the coded message, would then be put in this egg, and it would be hand-delivered to Churchill. Well, what happens here? There's a code inside the egg. Okay. Now, this golden egg thing, this was known by the time J.K. Rowling was writing these novels. It just wasn't ready where you could actually go out and see them and hold them, you know, and all that kind of stuff. I think it's a little element of British history finding its way into an element of the novels. So what does Harry do? He gets the egg, which leads us to the second task. He's got to figure out what the code means inside. Okay? Harry helped Diggory. Harry told Cedric, we got to get past the dragons. How does Cedric return the favor? Go take a bath and take your egg with you. Is that really quite the same as what Harry said? No. He doesn't say, Harry, go up to the third floor boys' bath, prefect's bath. Take a bath, take the egg under the water, and listen to what it says. That would have been, we got to get past the dragons. He just says, go take a bath and bring your egg. What kind of clue is that, right? So, what happens at the end of the task?
Ron and Harry make up.
Why? What makes Ron come back?
He's scared to death.
He figures somebody really is trying to kill Harry after he sees what happens, okay, in the contest against the dragons. And then we get Hermione's House Elf Liberation Front. Rita Skeeter's back, talks with Hagrid some, which I'm going to skip. Harry sees Dobby. They have to go and try and help Winky, since Winky's now at Hogwarts. What does it turn out? Why does Winky need an intervention? Winky's a drunk elf. Okay. But Winky won't say anything bad against her former owners. And then we get the unexpected task. What is the unexpected task? They have to dance at the Yule Ball. And Harry apparently has two left feet. But what's really the unexpected task? It's not dancing at the Yule Ball. That's the easy part. It's finding a date. It's being a 14-year-old boy and having to summon the courage to invite a girl on a date. And Harry and Ron, being the morons that they are, do what? They wait till the last moment. Because they always think, well, there's Hermione. And no one's going to ask Hermione. Because Hermione looks how? She doesn't look like Emma Watson. Just put it that way. She's not cute. She has big, bushy hair. You know, I don't know what that means. Church lady hair or like a fro or hair that's just not well kept. And she has big teeth. Because she goes and sees Madame Pomfrey, and Madame Pomfrey gives her the den shrinkio, her tooth shrinker, and she drinks it, and she says, you tell me when to stop. And Hermione's like, I'm getting them done right. So that they're shrunk and they're perfectly sized now. So when Hermione shows up at the ball, how does she look? Stunning. Just drop dead gorgeous. And it makes Ron feel jealous. So why does Ron feel jealous? Because he's never wanted to admit it before, but he has the hots for Hermione. And Hermione says, well, if you wanted to invite me, you should have asked me. Showing she likes him too. But they're both too pig-headed to ever admit it. Okay? Little element of Shakespeare's Much Ado About Nothing. You have Benedict and Beatrice here. Okay? So, Harry goes and invites Cho. But she's already been invited by pretty boy, Cedric. So they end up going with the Patel twins, who aren't supposed to be ugly by any means. Padme and Parvati. Patel. And how do Harry and Ron treat Padme and Parvati?
Terrible.
terribly. So they ditch, the girls, ditch Harry and Ron. Okay? So Harry and Ron go out because the party's just no fun. Page 406. Harry gets another letter from Sirius. I'm really trying to go through this as quickly as possible. And Sirius says, good job. You know, I was going to tell you about conjunctivitis. Make it so that the dragon couldn't even see because dragons already have bad eyesight. He says, but don't get complacent. Keep your eye out. In other words, constant vigilance. Okay? Harry wakes up Christmas Day. Dobby gives him his present. Harry gives Dobby a present. Okay? Socks. Socks are Dobby's favorite clothes. After all, they what bought him his freedom. I'm going to skip a bunch. Let's see. Harry and Ron go out. They overhear the conversation between Snape and Karkaroff. They overhear the conversation between Hagrid and Madame Maxime. And Ron's like, we need to go. And here's why, page 429. And Ron says, did you know Hagrid was a giant? Harry's like, no. Okay. Cedric tells Harry about the bath. Page 430. Hagrid's like, so what if, Harry's like, so what if Hagrid's a giant? Ron, well, no one who knows him will care because they'll know he's not dangerous. But, you know, giants are vicious. Just, you know, killers. They like killing. Everyone knows that. What is Ron telling us? Or what is Ron betraying? Are all giants killers? No. So what is this belief? It's a prejudice. Now, we are going to see what happens in some giants later on. When Hagrid tells Harry, Ron, and Hermione about what happened when he and Maxime went off on the envoy to the giants. Those giants pretty much are killers. Okay, but we do see Hagrid's little bigger brother, Grop. Who isn't a killer? Unless you kind of make him. So, Cedric tells Harry about the thing, the clue. And then we get Dumbledore's giant mistake. Rita Skeeter's next big scoop. And it's a long article, and we get all of it. Okay? So now everybody in the Wizarding World who reads the Daily Prophet hears Hagrid is a half-giant, and Dumbledore has employed Hagrid. What is this telling us about Dumbledore? Could be one of two things. It can make you look at Dumbledore one of two ways. Either he's very compassionate and understanding and willing to overlook what other people take to be faults, or he's dangerous. He allows violent people. I mean, after all, who did he have as Defense Against the Dark Arts teacher the previous year? A werewolf. Werewolves? Giants? What will be next? Servants of Lord Voldemort? Nope, sorry, that was book one. Narcissist? No, sorry, that was book two. Okay. Dangerous, dangerous stuff. So, Hagrid runs off and hides. Okay? Bagman tries to help Harry and such. I'm going to skip a bunch. They're off at the Three Broomsticks. Hermione overhears some conversation with Rita Skeeter. And on page 451, Hermione challenges Rita Skeeter. She says, you horrible woman. You don't care, do you? Anything for a story. Anyone will do, won't they? Even Ludo Bagman. And she goes, I know things about Ludo Bagman. What? That would make your hair curl. Okay? What does Hermione thing mean when she says anything for a story? Well, say that again.
No morals.
No morals. What has Rita Skeeter written about Harry? Lies. Yep. What has she written about Dumbledore? Lies.
Yellow journalism.
Yellow journalism. Okay. Why do you think Rowling does this?
It's true most of the time.
Because a lot of it's true. Now, you have to understand there's a difference between the American press and British press. Well, there used to be a difference between the American press and the British press. One of my colleagues who teaches in London every other summer, he's a communications professor at Belmont. And one of the things he teaches, one of the things he talks about frequently, is the difference between American and British media. Because British media does not pretend to be objective. They kind of let their, you know, preconceptions and their presuppositions all hang out. I mean, you know what is really liberal media over there. Because they go after the government or they go after the right wing, lock, stock, and barrel. Whereas we have this veneer of objectivity. You know, the New York Times is supposed to be objective. The New York Times is about the least objective thing you could find in America. Or the three major networks, broadcast networks, ABC, CBS, NBC. Okay. Fox News advertises, you know, it's more conservative tip. MSNBC does not pretend to be liberal. It says it's objective. It's not even close. There's a recent Pew research study. 85% of what you see on MSNBC is liberal opinion. 55% of what you see on Fox News is conservative opinion. That is, 55% of it is opinionated, is not news. 45% of it is news. 15% of what's on MSNBC is news. Okay? Well, Rowling has been a recipient of a lot of media hype. And we're going to see between this book and book five, she pulls off the gloves to go after the media. Because she's had her fill of it, apparently, by the time you get to book five. So, here's where we're going to pick up on Tuesday. Around page 453 or so, when Harry, Ron, and Hermione go to Hagrid to essentially tell him, come back to class. And I'm going to do my best to finish Goblet on Tuesday. Which probably means we're going to have to skip a lot more than I would necessarily want to.
Is this the only book we need to read on Tuesday?
Yeah.